So, hello. As John said, my name is Krzysztof Romanowski, and I'm here from Virtus Lab. And today, I want to talk not to how to speed the compiler, because I don't touch anything about compiler. I want to tell you how to avoid using your compiler and get your sources compiled. And before we start, there is a small discount to Scala Days Copenhagen I can give you. And I need a project that I can test my plugin. So if you want that one, or you just want to send me a project that I can test my plugin on, send me using any way. You can tweet with that. You can send me a message on Gitter or any other way. And during the end of the conference, I will just randomly pick one project and handle the discount. If you like, it's not much. It's only 15 euros. But we may use that. I don't want that. I don't need that. So. As John said, I will be talking how to don't repeat ourselves compiling the code. This is the idea. So there was a talks about how to speed up the compiler. I mean, there's a Triple Goat guy somewhere. There's a Rory. They work on that. I tried this path, and I probably not smart enough to speed up the compiler. So I took another road, and I tried to avoid the compilation as much as possible. So now, I want to ask you, so you raise your hands, how many time do you spend on daily basis compiling the code? So if you can raise your hand, if you compile your code for around 10 seconds, it's like not a full build, just a standard build like you do every time. I think that would be like much more hands in the air. So you don't do incremental compilation at all? You compile it, that's rare. Okay. And around a minute?
Incremental changes?
Just. Common time for your build. Like, this is usually how you wait for your compilation. No. Just it can be incremental. It don't need to be clean. So okay, again, 10 seconds for like incremental one. Okay, a minute. Five or more. Okay, I hope I don't see that many hands. So maybe this talk is for you. So I mean, 1 minute is fine. We can wait that much. 5 minutes is slang. It's not that good, but it's still manageable. Even more, it's not that pleasant anymore. And this is some numbers I took from few open source project. And what I did, I just go to all of these GitHubs, check out master, and come back. I mean, compile that code with master. Come back one or three commits in case of Akka because it was really small, and start the compilation. So the first time was this is the code one, so it was the first initial incremental compilation. And later on, I don't turn off SBT and switch back to the original branch and do the compilation again. So as you can see, it was pretty much the same compilation. As you can see, the worm compilation is much faster. And Rory pointed it out, guys from Triple Quad also. So this is really important. Keep your SBT alive as much as you can. If you need to change a branch, do it in the another console, or there is a plugin for that in SBT, if I recall correctly, that you can run git commands, for example, from the SBT. And as I said, most of this build is incremental. That is why they are fast. And if we switch to the full builds and their times, now, whose project builds like from the bot from the scratch in 10 seconds? I hope I see one hand or two. It's none. Okay, it's even worse than I expected. So around a minute. You are lucky, guys. I wish I can work with your teams. And 5 minutes. 50, 20. And more? Yeah. This is the and to be honest, this long compilation around an hour is my background. I mean, I'm not actually working on that workspace, but I have to provide the tooling for that. This is my daily job. So the idea comes from that workspace. So maybe if you're compiling for 5 minutes, you don't want to spend that much time on actually speed up the compilation, but it is an hour, this is a problem. And for me, it's not only that I waste an hour, or I waste 5 minutes in my life waiting for compiler to finish. I don't wait like a machine. I usually doing something else in that time, which means that I completely switch the context in my head. So whenever compilation finished, I have to rebuild all the stuff. I have to remember what I was doing before. What was my plan? And this takes time. So for me, it's not like 5 minutes. If there is a 5 minute compilation, it's 5 minutes. And this amount of time that you require, your brain requires to start up again, to fetch all the caches, let's say. And yeah, as I promised. Yes. So let's back to the numbers. And previously it was quite nice. It was like 20 seconds, 15 seconds. Right now we are 5 minutes almost for Scala debugger. And this is not, to be honest, this is not only main, this is also with test, because from the Scala debugger, I mean, the normal classes compile quite fast, but if you add the test to that, it becomes really, really painful. So can we do better? So this is the time that I hope I can show you something. This is I'm doing the same talk on Scala Days, and if this fail, this will be the answer. We can't. So okay, so this is an NSIM server. Sorry, caps. And you have to believe me that I don't mess up with clean command. Clean command work as normal command. Yeah, so it's clean. I can show you the output, but I hope it's not needed. Okay, so before I can start right now the compilation, but we have to wait 3 minutes, so I don't want to do that. Before I do anything more, I just call one command that is called stash apply. And wait a little bit. Okay, no red, 8 seconds. We are good. And right now, let's see how much time the compilation will took. Some formatting, and we are done. I'm going to prove it that there is a bytecode there, and everything works. I just start test. One more formatting. I don't know why, but formatting is not my case. And this is not the compilation. This is the startup of the test. It's enzyme, so Sam probably knows better. Yeah. Okay, I'll just kill that. I don't want to wait for a test because this is not the scope. And we can do this for the Scala debugger. And it was like almost twice the time of the build. So again, clean, stash apply. It also takes a few seconds in mostly copying the binaries and loading them. It's 6 in this time. And let's start the test. And we are got our test. Of course, I'm a little bit cheating over here, because if we did that for Akka, I don't want to do that, but instead of 300 seconds, I got 139. I think this is caused by because there's a lot of formatting done, and SBT reports that there is a source that are changed, so the formatter might be not quite good. And another part is that there is this multi-JVM thing that adds another scope to the compilation, and I'm not supporting that at this point. But even if there is some things that my plugin doesn't support, it still like reduces compilation times 2 times or even more. Of course, this is ideal example, because I created caches because this is a caching, no magic. And I created caches exactly for that commit, so for that code. So this is the ideal world. So you just met Hoarder, and this is my plugin. And this is, sorry, and this kind of Hoarder, because I learned this is not a common English word. So this is a guy that keep all the stuff together, not Hoarder, because somebody mistaked us earlier. So it's not a Hoarder, it's Hoarder. I think that's HBO might sue me if I use a Hoarder there, so yeah. So as I said, this is a SBT plugin. And it's live. I mean, the first version is released today morning. And there is a bug in the slide, because there should be one more. This should be 101, because I did a mistake in the morning. So there is no 1.0 version. And if you need more documentation, this is the link. It will be shown in the end, so you don't need to like do it right completely. Take a photo or something like that. So the idea that is behind this plugin is called, I mean, I called it this way, it's called cached compilation. And cached compilation, for me, it's a combination of cache and incremental compilation. So what I'm doing in Horder, I actually create an engine and some stuff around that to actually cache the compilation results. And I mean, caching the class files is super easy. I mean, anyone can copy a class files and store it somewhere. But if you copy this class files to the output of your project, you will still get the full compilation because you are missing the metadata. And I will be talking a little bit more about that. So, it might be a common, but what I'm doing in this plugin is doing this load cache and compile. So, the first thing that I mean is loading the cache. Because in the examples I show, it was ideal world, so we were exactly in the same commit, so we don't need to compile anything. But it's not like I decide for that; it's how it's a compiler decided for me. But if I'm like I don't know one commit away or I did a change, so the cached compilation will trigger. And how it does it work? I mean, this is not the implementation. This is just to show you how it works. And I don't like driving graphs. I think the source code is better for that. So the loading the cache, it means that you can imagine that we magically come back to the commit where the cache was created or the sources where the cache was created, do the normal compilation, then come back to our compilation and let's trigger the compilation. If you look in this form, it makes no sense because we are paying for a full compilation and then we are paying for incremental compilation. But if we are able to cache this part and just load the metadata and the binaries, this can be quite fast. And the 6 seconds that you saw before on this 8 seconds was actually the time to do this. So this is time to load the binaries and extract the metadata. And why do I think that this idea is so powerful? First of all, it reduces the compilation time. But it's also flexible. I mean, we don't have to be exactly on the cache. We can be, I don't know, 2 commits away. This is quite transparent. I mean, right now I have to call some task to actually load the metadata. But later on, I plan to do it like it will be completely transparent for user. And this suits to normal compilation, so I don't have to do anything special. I can just apply the cache and start working. And the following compilation will be incremental. So no magic done. I mean, it exactly mimics the full compilation, but not taking that much time. And also, that is a cache and incremental compilation. So it also reduces the amount of caches that you need. Because if there is a small change, you can skip the cache for that change because we can do the incremental compilation from that. And if there is a big incremental compilation after some changes, because I don't know, I change one implicit or add a new macro or change something in macro, then it's probably a good candidate to be cached. Of course, this is not yet supported because the plugin is quite young. I mean, I start working on that. I mean, the idea is for a year with me. And I did some work with different integration than SBT, but with the same idea. And I applied that for a bigger code base. I mean, this 1 hour of compilation I mentioned before. And due to the slow cache extraction, but I will be working on that, but I managed with one cache a day. But this is, you probably said, OK, this is enough. There is probably a day there is no merges to the main branch. No. If there is a day where there is like 40 pull requests merged, it's a quiet day. I mean, in hot days, it was like, I don't know, 100 PRs merged. So with one cache a day, I was able to cut down the compilation with the slow extraction time like twice for any commit when the user reports. I got, of course, some problems when the compilation was longer, but it was only the cases where, from some reason, cache was not applied. So this is really powerful idea, and especially I have to fix that to make it better. It is as good as incremental compiler. And I don't know if you know, but there is a lot of work right now done for the incremental compiler that is called Zinc. This is a part of SBT that was extracted from SBT. And right now Scala Center start to contributing to that. And you should be really excited. And when you migrate to newer version of incremental compiler, I hope soon we are migrating to new version of SBT, because it will make incremental compilation much, much faster. I mean, much less classes will be recompiled for the same change, because the algorithm will be better. Yeah, so let's back to the machinery of this thing. If you got any question, just ask it right now. I don't want to, that you get lost at any point. Come on.
Is this thing on? Yeah. This caching, do you do this mainly for clean builds from a new branch in your CI, or do you want to use this locally because you are hitting one of the hard problems of computer science, cache invalidation?
I mean, yeah, I probably didn't mention that, but I started from the last question, from the cache invalidation. I do not have to think about cache invalidation, because the only thing I can lose in that case, if the incremental compiler works fine, is the time. Because if I load the cache and it appears that it's completely useless, so the incremental compiler will do a full compilation. So the only thing I mean that is broken is that I waste, I don't know, 10 seconds to load the cache.
Yeah, but
so it not a big problem. And let's do the first question. I got multiple ideas how I can use that. For now, it's for a clean build, or just change a branch, or, but to be honest, if you can generate a cache and use that cache for some reason, this cached compilation idea will apply. And I will talk later a little bit about how I can, what I plan to support with my plugin. But for now, there's the only thing that's implemented is manually caching and applying the cache, because it's the simplest, and as I said, it's only 1 month old, and I'm doing this in my free time in evening, so I don't have that much time. Is there anything more?
Yeah, because I wouldn't do any clean compiles if I can help it.
Yeah, but for some reason, sometimes you have to do a clean compilation, except especially that sometimes the state of your workplace might be totally broken.
Yeah, but then your cache might also be totally broken.
Yeah, this is your risk. So, but if you don't need that, I mean, you are a lucky person. But if for some reason you need that, then this is for you, I hope.
Well, that's why I figured this would be very helpful in CI. If
yes.
You somehow manage to inject a cache into a newly checked out workspace, then your CI, the initial one, is always way slower than all the others.
Yes, I agree. And yes, I probably know what you want to say, because we talked about this like an hour ago.
So I don't think you had mentioned it yet, but so his caching stores the metadata in the class files, I guess, in like a common.
I will show that in a second.
Yeah. So yeah, to the point of the continuous integration, I think it'll be really useful there, because before I was trying to go through all the target directories and find all the data and grab it myself, whereas his plugin makes it a lot simpler for me to basically just snapshot it when I say I merge into master, and then when anyone does a PR and I'm running on the continuous integration, I can just pop it off and be good to go. So that, I think that's really useful.
Yeah. So to be honest, the original idea was actually to generate this stuff on PR, on CI side, and use it on workspace side. But right now we are involving that pull request pull request validation PR CIs. We'll do the cached compilation and decide also if given commit, given change requires a new cache, because I can measure just the compilation time, and this is the only measure I need. And this later on, before the merge or after the merge, I do the full build because I want to be safe, and I don't need to wait for that much. Sure.
I may be missing something, but how does it compare to Zinc server?
This uses Zinc, and okay. This is Zinc metadata. So we've got the Zinc server. Zinc server is something that is alive, and keeps the incremental compilation metadata and do an incremental compilation. But you can kill off this thing, and I don't know if we're talking about the same thing, to be honest. But Zinc like is able to store the metadata on the drive, so we don't need to keep it alive. But with the server, you don't need to read it from the drive, and this might be a little bit slow, because if you do, especially for a small change, if you just add, I don't know, comment in the class, in the source file, you don't want to wait a few seconds for Zinc to load the cache, to load the metadata. And another reason why the server is so important is to keep the JVM hot. And this, as I showed, as Rory showed, as the triple quote guys showed, that this can reduce build times by 30-40%.
Hi, do you have a way of publishing these caches to something like Maven Central, Suna type, something?
This is an idea I'm working on. It will be later on. I will talk a little bit more about that.
Yeah,
and this, I got even idea based on that idea, but later on with the presentation, don't worry. Okay, is there like anything more around the idea? Because about the integration, I got like prepared something later on, so. Okay, so where I was. I mean, my computer broke. I mean. Is it okay? Yeah, this is, I hate this part of presentation when something goes. Okay, we are live again. So, I was about the storing of the metadata. So, maybe I can show you right now the metadata because I described briefly. I mean, I'm loading a binaries and loading a metadata. Metadata is the key to the whole thing because the incremental compilation without the metadata is just a full build. The metadata from the incremental compilation, it's all what keeps the incremental compiler works. I mean, this is all the connections between the source files. So whenever you change one source files, you need to know what other source files need to be recompiled. This is all about this metadata. And yeah, you can inspect your metadata for your MySBT build if you like. You can just run a show int compiler setup task. Do you know how show meta task work? Okay, so show basically in, I mean, do you know or not? No. Okay. So this is just a result of the task, and there is a case class. This internal stuff of SBT, but the fourth argument to that, this is a path to metadata file, and it can be computed. It's usually something like that. So it's actually the cache directory of the int compile setup task, but you don't have to do that because there is output. It's quite long, as you may see. There is format is a little bit. I mean, simple, but it do the work. And the thing that you might probably notice that is that there is absolute paths use. And the main problem with that metadata file from the perspective of the cache compilation is that it is really workspace specific. So it's specific for your workspace. Even if you rename the top directory of your workspace for some reason, you don't touch any source, you will do a full compilation. And actually the cached compilation idea was based on this question of Stack Overflow. Somebody was asking why SBT and how can I prevent that, recompiles everything when I rename the top directory when the sources is stored. So now you know the reason. And this is not only an absolute path that this is a problematic one. There is much more things that are workspace specific, and I fixed that problem by creating something called analysis mappers. So this is the mappers that have actual map. Mapper is a really simple thing. It's able to load. I mean to change this argument like file to the string and load from that string. So as simple as it can be, and. The main idea here is that I exactly know the scope, so I exactly know that I'm mapping the output. Right now I'm mapping the source, so I know what is the main directory for that. So whenever I'm like when I'm mapping sources, I can just query SBT to get the source root, and like replace the source with some absolutes with some placeholders. And when I'm loading this metadata, I can just fill the gaps. So nothing really, I mean, you just need to know where to look, and Zinc is quite complicated. And you have to spend a little bit of time to get what was wrong. I mean, how does it work, where it load the stuff? But this is already done. And this is merged, I mean, this is merged to SBT, to Zinc 1.0. And for older SBT, I just take this idea and implement it myself, but once we will all switch to new Zinc, I can throw away this branch. And this is how the file looks like when I apply the transformation. So as you said, as you can see, it's simple placeholders, no magic there. And right now we come to the point that it's probably the most difficult question to answer. I mean, where is my cache and which cache should I use? And because this general idea is actually, it's all in Zinc, so why we do need my plugin? Why do we need a holder? So we need a holder to actually find and load and create the caches. Yeah. So right now, as I mentioned, this is a quite young project. So the only one workflow is supported. It's /apply. The second one I'm working on is called cache released. It's exactly what some want to ask. And more in the future. I will talk a little bit later about the plans. So /apply. As I said, this is the simplest workflow. It can be used anywhere without setting anything. And when you are using stash or /apply workflow, none of standard SBT task is changed. I only add a new task. So it should be quite safe to add this as your global plugin with the /apply workflow as a utility for you. Or you might, of course, use that in like on the CI context or build any tooling around that. But the main idea is to just do the ad hoc stuff. Like you are working on one branch and you have to come back to another. So we don't want to do an incremental compilation over the place. You can stash one, go back to another branch, do your work, come back, /apply, and you are good to go. You don't wait for a compilation. And if you are doing like at some point, if I don't know, version of the Scala changed in your project, it sometimes happened, and you have to come back to the old one. This is a tool for you. And yeah, so stash, as you can see, expects two things. I mean, the first thing is project label, and the second one is version label. I feed it by default, and project is the name of the top directory of your project. I mean, so in this case, it's enzyme server, because this is the default name of when you clone the repository. And the version is head, if I recall correctly, something. And I mean, this is just identifiers. So, and I don't do any checks if when you stash something, it's your responsibility to stash to good place, I mean, to stash with good name and to load. I mean, stash is not that tricky, but to load from a good place. So if, for example, if you got a stash for Akka, and I mean, this is a bad because this is old version. When you do a stash from Akka and you want to load that in Enzyme server, you might expect, I mean, I didn't test it. I mean, I tested a little bit briefly, and if something like fail and blow up, you are warned. So you should be responsible for loading and the good cache. Yeah. And so you basic thing like you cannot stash twice to the same directory. I just want to show that. And yeah, it will fail. And of course there is a settings that you can override that to make it happen, but we can stash it as I don't know. ES4 version V1. And as you can see, the stash takes roughly the same time as stash apply. Of course, this workspace is fully compiled. If you have a clean workspace and you do that, the full compilation will be triggered, including tests, because I need the class files to stash. And with stash apply, it's the same story. You also need to provide the project and version labels. And stash apply has to clean the output because it's applying the classes for the full project. Maybe I will do it a little bit higher. And you can change this behavior using settings. So you can just fail if there are some classes. You can just clean everything or clean only the class files. And for me, this is really useful to test the engine because there is almost no moving parts. More of the documentation is on the GitHub. And the second thing I'm right now working on is a cached release. And the idea here is that we have a lot of class files lying all over the places. I mean, we got this huge Maven repository and there's tons of Scala code, but you can use it as a library. You cannot use it as to set up your project. And the idea here is that you can release together with your class files, with documentation, with your source files, also the incremental compilation metadata that can be imported. So later on, for example, you are in maybe not less open source, but like less production environment. I mean the corporation one. So you got a lot of releases, and one of that broke. And this is like really old one, and you want to come back to that point. So instead of just compiling everything from scratch, and you do it quickly because you are losing money of that version, you can just use the released version with the metadata to set up your workspace faster. I don't know, it might be 5 minutes, 10 minutes, but if you're losing, I don't know, $1 million per hour, it's actually, it can save you a lot of money. And also, later on, I plan to support, because right now the thing I'm working on is you have to provide a version, and it will try to do a normal dependency resolution, go on the class files, and go on the incremental compilation metadata apply, and this is how I plan it to work. But later on, I plan to support current and last versions. So if you want to if you type current, so it will look, I don't know, in the commit history and search for a tag with the release and pick the lastest, or just find the lastest version of your code. Plans for future. The first one I need to do a lot is testing, because I can only test it myself right now. So if you have if you want to speed up your compilation and you want to just come to the hackathon today, we can try to set up a hardware for your project, and we'll see how much we can speed up and if it will work for you. Because as I said, I can only test a few things, and testing the incremental compilation is triple that hard as testing a normal compilation, because you got all this complexity of Scala compiler, of Scala sources, and you have to support incremental compilation. So you have to support transition from each possible Scala sources to another. And then with cache, you got another step, because you have to support multiple environments, loadings, and changings. So it's impossible to test anything or even be close to, I don't know, 10% of possible things. So the only thing to make it to be sure that it's really work is actually to test on the live code basis. And I don't know how you work. I mean, I work in some specific way. You probably, everybody has his own way of work, and it also affects this thing. So that is why we need to test it on with you. So that is why I need your help. And for this stuff I mentioned, I plan to create a support for SBT 1.0. It should be pretty straightforward, especially that SBT 1.0, including changes I mentioned, is released. And also Scala Center, I mean, I don't know, it's not Scala Center. It's your work, yeah? Okay. But I'm asking about this SBT, old SBT with the new Zinc stuff. Yeah. So if this come up, I really want to support also that. And later on, I plan to support IDEs. I mean, in the other solution I mentioned before that I'm working on in like my paid hours, let's say, we got integration with IDE, but I will try to move it, I mean, IntelliJ. So maybe I hope I will be able to create a pull request to IntelliJ Scala plugin with that. I hope I can. I mean, if there is no like problems with, I don't know, legal stuff and stuff like that. And the another thing, that's Arek. I don't know if there's Arek. Yeah, like show me that he could have a problem. And this is what I call incremental aware library dependencies. So I don't know if any of you have a library that is maintained by you, and this is a common library. In a commercial application, it might be user management. And you have user management in multiple of your applications, and it's used like really commonly in your, like almost in every class on your code, but this is a library. And the problem is that whenever you change that library, so I don't know, you change the name of the admin, something like that, and you release a new version and import that to your project, it will recompile every usage of that project, because this is the way housing works. I mean, if there is no metadata provided, it cannot infer what needs to be compiled. And what I plan to do, I plan to support this for these libraries. So you can define that this library has a metadata attached with the cached release, and not just run this library, but run the metadata and treat that library as project in your SBT, more or less, a subproject or module. So it should speed up the compilation on the events when you change the version of the library. And for the last, there is, I plan a few new workflows. The first thing is abstract cache provider. So I want to allow anyone to define where the cache is and provide the tooling to actually make it easy to load that caches. The second thing is to provide, when I got that, the first one, to provide the cache detection mechanism. So I can say, just do the cached compilation, and it will find the cache for me. so I don't have to provide the label version or something like that. So it probably will use something like Git commit base, or again, use my user to decide, because I don't know, they use Perforce and they got some strange things. I don't know the workspaces. And my goal, like the holy grail, is to automatic cache application. So the idea here is that somehow I got some ideas, but I need to test them. You don't need to write anything. You just type a compilation, and if the compiler decides that I have to compile a lot, it will just search for cache, and if cache is close enough, it will use the cache instead of compiling everything. So it will be like completely transparent to the user. And then maybe like the common build times will drop to the incremental compilation level. This is my goal. And this is all I prepared. If you got any questions, this is the perfect time to do so.
Do you support generated sources?
For example, I've been using like generated sources from WSDL, right? And these classes come up, and when the WSDL changes, the generated sources change, and they are still used in the projects. Did you do some testing on this?
I mean, I support anything that Zinc supports. Maybe there might be some problems with the mappings, but I need to check that. But this is quite easy to solve. But generally, Zinc, whenever you start the compilation, it do a hashing the source files, and if given hash changed, it's invalidate that file and do the recompilation. So whenever you're generating the same sources all over again, you won't see the compilation. I need to check the paths.
Okay. Next question. Okay.
Yeah. So thank you for all for coming.
Maybe I will ask one question.
Oh, sure. Sorry.
You says that your holy grail is that. You will automatically pull the cache if it will exist, and the full compilation will be needed. And this is a bit scary, because I have a lot of problems with macros. For example, there is a library, MicroPickle from Lihaui, that just broke something. I didn't know when, but when I refactor something in my code, it just crashes. And yeah, if this will will be in cache, then I will clean my production code, I will try to build in again, and still I have this problem. And I will no idea that the problem occurs because I hit a cache, and I will try to find it in a code, and this could be a problem, and pretty big problem.
Yes, I see, but this is the price that you has to pay if you want to be faster. And I don't know if I will use for that standard compilation. Maybe I will provide cached compilation or fast compilation task, or underway I will create a task that will follow up to all behavior, so we can do a clean and normal compilation in the end. But this is a trade-off. I mean, I know that there is a cases where Scala compiler is not, I mean, incremental compiler do their work, but Scala compiler is limited. One of that, I think Julian mentioned that, it's package objects. Package objects is really pain if you do anything around the Scala compiler, because, I don't know if it's broken. I'm not smart enough to say that it's broken or not. But this is a pain, because when you compile a package object, you're in the same compilation unit, you have to have all the dependencies from. I mean, if you got the class files, if your package object extends, I don't know, my class that lives in like nearby, you have to compile these two files together, because if you compile one, it will fail. Okay, thank you all. And if you got any questions, grab me somewhere on corridor or join the hackathon. I will be there. I don't know. I might join like other hacks, but if you want to do something with order, I will be there for you. Thank you.